Okay, so I see more people are joining and arriving, which is great. So I think we'll begin. Firstly, thank you everyone for joining us today for this webinar discussion on sustainable leasing and green lease provisions. It's great to see that so many of you have an interest in this topic, and we've assembled a fantastic panel for this session, who I'll introduce shortly. A few housekeeping notes before we begin. We have 1 hour for this discussion, although we aim to finish slightly earlier than that. In terms of structure, we're going to start the session with a general discussion of green leases and the updated BBP Green Lease Toolkit. We'll then go on to talk about some of the challenges and opportunities that the new toolkit presents, and finish by grappling with some of your questions and comments in the Q&A. Please do use the Q&A function for questions throughout. We'll try and answer as many as we can towards the end of the session. If we don't get to answer your question live, we will get to it and come back to you separately after the event. Finally, today's session will be recorded, uploaded to our website at Gowling, and circulated via a follow-up email. There'll be a very short feedback survey pop up at the end, so please do let us have your thoughts on today's session. So let's begin. My name is Tom Baines, and I'm a partner in the real estate group at Gowling WLG. I specialise in commercial property development and investment, advising property companies, developers, investors, and owner-occupiers on schemes across the UK. My practice has a particular focus on industrial and logistics, as well as energy-related development projects and data centres. Often, this includes advising clients on their green lease provisions, whether part of negotiating terms for a particular transaction, or advising more widely on precedent documents. The reason we are together now, talking about green leases, is that the Better Building Partnership updated its Green Lease Toolkit last week. The toolkit was first published in 2008 and last updated over decades ago. It's been one of the few benchmarks and resources for green leasing terms and has grown in influence as sustainability issues have risen up the agenda for owners and occupiers of commercial property. Last week's update has been much anticipated due to the current interest and demand from landowners, occupiers and investors to deliver on their ESG goals. It's already made quite a splash, being described as a radical in Estates Gazette headline last week. To discuss the new toolkit, I'm joined today by Laura Thrower, Responsible Property Investment Analyst at Royal London Asset Management, Kirsty Draper, Head of Sustainability for UK Agency at JLL, my colleague Nick Bridgman, a senior lawyer here at Gowling, who has extensive experience negotiating leases on behalf of occupiers and advising them on their portfolios. Laura, let's start with you. Would you like to introduce yourself and say a bit about your role and your experience with green leases?
Yes, thanks so much, Tom. Hi to everyone who's joined today. So as Tom mentioned, my name is Laura Thrower and I work as a Responsible Property Investment Analyst at Royal London Asset Management. For those who don't know Royal London Asset Management or RLAM, RLAM is a multi-asset or asset management business with about 160 billion of assets under management. Of that, 8 billion sits within our property portfolio, which is comprised of about 230 buildings, mainly across office, retail and industrial spaces, and we've got about 1,300 occupiers. My main focuses in my role are implementing our net zero carbon pathway, which was launched at the end of 2021, targeting net zero across our directly managed assets and developments by 2030 and across our indirectly managed assets by 2040. And in addition to that, also implementing our responsible property investment strategy. So green leases has been very much a big part of my role and focus since joining 2.5 years ago. We have a very heavily single let portfolio. We do have a number of multi-let offices, about 30 of those 230. So green leases are a really key tool for us in order to collaborate with our occupiers, ensure we can help drive towards our own net zero carbon ambitions, as well as help our occupiers on that journey as well.
Great, thank you, Laura. Nick, tell us a bit about yourself and where you deal with green leases.
Hi, everybody. So I'm Nick Bridgman. I'm a principal associate here at Gowling WLG. I've been with the firm for about 13 years now. I do actually act for landlords as well as tenant, but my practice focuses mainly on institutional tenants in the retail, office and industrial sectors. So today I'll be speaking in my capacity as a tenant advisor. Over the last few years, I've been advising a number of key clients on ESG strategy and MEES and the impact of green leases in particular.
Great. And finally, Kirsty, you've been part of the BBP steering committee developing the toolkit update. So please tell us a bit about your role and talk us through how the update has come about.
Sure. So Kirsty Draper, I head up sustainability for our UK agency business. I've actually been at JLL for over 20 years now, 13 of which I spent in central London capital markets. So I've very much got a commercial background. I took on an ESG lead role at the end of 2015, which in 2015 didn't take up very much of my time. Turns out not that many people wanted to talk about sustainability back then. But then suddenly the momentum around sustainability grew, as did the demand on my time. And so this turned into a full-time role just over 2 years ago. So I work with our agency business to look at how we embed sustainability into our business line. Obviously, as agents, we're often the people kind of negotiating those headline terms of leases. And so understanding green leases and the benefits of green leases and being able to articulate those is a really key part of what we do here at JLL. But as you said, Tom, yeah, I also sat on the steerco for the BBP Green Lease Toolkit update, which was fantastic. It was a really amazing experience. It's interesting because I think around the collaboration piece, you know, we all know that in order to decarbonize, we need to collaborate. And it was really nice seeing that firsthand. We had a really diverse range of people as part of that steer group. And, you know, we didn't always agree on everything completely. But I think the conversation and the debate that we had ended up creating a much more kind of balanced and robust toolkit. So it was really great to be part of that.
Great. Thanks, Kirsty. Now, as I mentioned, the toolkit was only updated last week, and clearly it's going to take time for people to get their heads around it, think about what it might mean for them and their approach to leasing going forward. There's a lot to unpack, but I want to start by asking all of you about your initial reaction. Is there something, a theme, a clause, an idea that has jumped out at you straight away? Something that excites or maybe concerns you? Laura, let's start with you.
Sure. I think that one of the great developments of the new toolkit is the different shades of green, as how the BBP describe it. So under the different suggested lease clauses that you can add in, they've got a light, a medium, and a dark shade of green. So if you wanted to more have a light touch approach to one of the clauses, whether it's social impact or looking at renewable energy, you've got different variations of that. And I think as a landlord, where we have quite a diverse portfolio regarding sectors, but also, you know, the multi-let offices versus the single let, I think it's important that we have that variation, because there's definitely different levels of maturity of our occupiers on their ESG journey. We've got some who have really, you know, hard corporate net zero carbon science-based target commitments, particularly in the office sector. We've got a lot of smaller multi-let industrial tenants, as an example, where they may just be starting their ESG journey. So I think having that variety where we can, you know, engage with the occupiers, see what makes sense for them, is really important, rather than having a one size fits all across the different clauses. So I think that'll be really useful for us across our different sectors.
Hey, thanks, Laura. I think that sort of distinction between the light, medium, dark is really interesting. And I'm sure it's something that we'll come onto a little bit later in terms of what the approach to that might be. Kirsty, what's your initial takeaway?
Gosh, where do I start? I think, as Laura said, for anyone who hasn't seen the toolkit yet, essentially it's a collection of about 20 clauses, which are really helpful. But for me, each of the clauses has got a preamble, so setting out why it's important. It then has a statement of intent, so actually what's the main driver behind that clause. And then, as Laura said, it's really helpfully got those different shades of green depending on where you are with your journey. For me, from an agency perspective, having that preamble and those statements of intent in really simple to understand language is super, super helpful. But I think the other thing that I really like about the toolkit is the flexibility that it's got in there. It's been designed to be a living toolkit. So previously, the old toolkit was a downloadable PDF, whereas now this is hosted in a live environment and there's even a feedback button. So actually, I would really encourage everyone to look at it. And if you have got feedback, you know, use that button, post it back. There's going to be some formal governance around that, but it is going to be kind of is going to be, you know, updated as time, as things do change. And so I like that flexibility. And I also like the fact that it's got, sorry, Nick, I'm stealing all the things here. But I also really, this is my last one, I promise. I really like the fact that it's got guidance around heads of terms as well, because I think that'll be really helpful with all negotiations. So,
great. I mean, from my perspective, one of the things that stands out, we've got these various different clauses in the toolkit, and there are, I think there's about 10 of them, which are described as being green lease essentials, which is a pretty strong term if you think about it. I mean, some of the terms that are included that are fairly commonplace, such as not impacting EPC ratings and data sharing and things like that. Others at the moment are probably a little less common, such as operating buildings sustainably, waste and reinstatement at the end of term, things like that. And I think it'll be interesting to see the extent to which landowners will align their precedents with the toolkit in these areas, perhaps going a little bit further than they've gone before. I think adoption of some of these provisions by modern commercial lease and other precedents might be helpful and influential in that too. But a related thought about this essential element for me is whether we will see more weight being placed on these provisions in valuations. You know, there's been a talk in the market for a while about whether buildings will attract a green premium or suffer a brown discount based on sustainability credentials. Clearly, leases feed into that. And to mine, calling these provisions essential points towards the latter, i.e. if a lease doesn't have them, is it now perhaps falling a little bit short of a standard? So I think landlords will be keen to include these types of provisions. And whereas they might have been prepared perhaps in the past to drop sustainability provisions in leases to get tenants signed up and to get deals done, I think that may not be something that we might be seeing so often going forward. And just the final thought on these essentials thing is, you know, the extent to which perhaps authorities might be looking at them when they're looking at greenwashing credentials and looking to enforce that. You know, are companies walking the walk by actually having these provisions in their leases rather than just saying that they are? So I think there's quite a lot of interesting points coming out of that. Nick, what about you? What stood out?
I think Kirsty and I think all three of you have probably covered the main points, but I think from a tenant's perspective, I guess it's important to view how a tenant will look at any changes like this. And I think as a population, tenants are a little bit nervous. I'm not saying necessarily that the toolkit is landlord friendly. I'm sure that Kirsty and I have already talked about the fact that there has been engagement with tenants and it is meant to be a balanced document. I just think that tenants will probably see it to be a little bit landlord friendly because all the usual provisions that they want to seek in terms of protections aren't necessarily covered there. Now, that's not to say that they haven't been taken into account in the production of the toolkit. It's not to say that they can't still make those arguments and get some of those protections still into the lease. But I think as a starting point, they'll be a little bit nervous to adopt even the light green approach. I think in terms of main points from a tenant's perspective, they're going to be looking at access provisions for landlords to undertake works and cost recovery mechanisms. And from my perspective, the big thing really is, will the MCL adopt some or all of the green lease provisions in the toolkit? And I think of the two documents, really, it's the MCL leases, which will probably hold most weight for practitioners in reality. So if the MCL ends up saying, we'll take out our environmental sustainability schedule, just go and have a look at the toolkit, that will obviously lend more weight, I think, to it when it comes to actually negotiating the clauses themselves.
Thank you, Nick. So go on, Kirsty.
I was just going to say, it's also probably worth mentioning that the toolkit isn't designed to be a standard or a certification. It really is meant to be really helpful guidance for people to use. And I think, you know, the industry has been crying out for it. I think I'm right in saying that even before this toolkit, the previous toolkit is the most downloaded of all the toolkits used by BBP. So it just demonstrates actually how much demand there is for it. Yeah. And I think, you know, it was also, it is... Some of the shades of green are stretching and they are designed to be stretching. And I think, you know, that's on purpose because the reality is if we want to decarbonize and create more sustainable real estate, we do need to change the way things have been done. And so, you know, we need that. And I think that level of ambition in there as well as an option.
Absolutely. So, I mean, bearing that in mind, Nick, what sort of conversations do you expect that you might be having with your occupying clients over the coming weeks and months as green lease provisions potentially evolve?
Yeah, I mean, it's important to acknowledge that obviously a lot of leases already have these provisions in them or provisions which are similar to this. So, you know, most of my institutional occupier clients see this on a regular basis. Obviously, the bigger the landlord, the more likely it is that they're going to include these leases within their precedence. So it's we're not seeing anything new in that regard. We're already having the conversation. It is, I think the conversation from a tenant's perspective needs to shift now to do we need to do anything immediately off the back of the toolkit? My response to that would be probably no, on the basis that it's the landlord's document to start with. And while it's a partnership between, you know, the parties as to how they go about their sort of joint ESG strategy, ultimately we sort of need to be guided by the landlord in terms of what their portfolio is saying. And so I think immediately they'll be saying, do we need to do anything? And the answer to that will be no, let's see what landlords come back to us with. I think they're also going to be asking, are landlords going to be more aggressive off the back of the toolkit? I would possibly say yes, given that, you know, as Kirsty said, you know, look, there's a drive to be more sustainable, and in order to achieve that, you know, we've got to be more realistic about how we can both landlord and tenant play a part in that. So necessarily tenants are going to have to probably accept in the long run that they're going to have to give more in terms of what they do and what they allow the landlord to do. I would also possibly say from a practical perspective, because we're seeing a lot on EV charging points and district energy networks in new developments, is it going to affect what we do with those clauses? At the minute, again, I'd say probably no, because I don't think the toolkit specifically references either of those things. But it's something, again, to be alive to. And, you know, we can have a look at how those clauses are applied more broadly. And I think lastly, the big issue for negotiating green lease clauses is, are we talking about an acquisition or a renewal? And that conversation makes a massive difference to how you frame a negotiation. You know, on a renewal, you have to balance, don't you, the commercial position, the commercial reality of the parties and what they're trying to achieve as against the OMA principles. So, you know, from a tenant's perspective, they will say, well, we're not going to allow you, landlord, just to chuck in a load more obligations than weren't in the existing lease, because we aren't obliged to have to agree those. And I know there was the Clipper Logistics case a couple of years ago, which touched on that briefly, but there's not real case law which sits behind it. So I think that the tenant's standard position will still be, under OMA, I'm going to say no. And if we have to have an argument about it, then so be it. But I'm relatively confident that we'll win that argument if push comes to shove.
Okay.
On an acquisition, however, anything goes. So, you know, that's a very different conversation.
Can I just add to that, though? Because it's really interesting hearing your view on that, Nick. In the market, I think the most interesting shift that I've seen, and I would say I've seen this over the last 6 to 12 months, is I think historically, as you say, green leases did tend to be something that were initially introduced by the landlord. But actually, I think the big shift that I've seen in the market is now we are having large occupiers requesting green leases. We are seeing occupiers develop their own green lease toolkits for across their occupied portfolio. And we're already, one of the services that we provide is to do kind of almost like a data scrape of leases for occupiers, looking at what terms they've got in there and then looking at points, whether that be reviews, break dates, renewals, and opportunities for how they can then introduce them. And so I know that's not all occupiers, but actually we are seeing that shift, which I think is quite an exciting trend.
Yeah, in fact, we've got a client that sends out a letter. So they, as a broad principle, they don't like to agree anything in a lease, but they will, as a matter of course, on any acquisition or renewal, they will send out a letter, which is non-binding, but they'll send it to the landlord saying, this is what we wish to achieve from an ESG perspective in respect of this particular property. And, you know, the landlord may look at that and go, well, if you sent me this, why won't you agree it in the lease? The answer to that from our client is, well, we just don't think the lease is the right place to put it, but we want to show you that we are committed to being green, which it sits, you know, sits in line with our own ESG strategy. So it's interesting to hear from you, Kirsty, that some occupiers are going the other way and saying, actually, we want our own clauses in. It'd be interesting to find out how those obligations actually sit in respect of the toolkit, because obviously a lot of the obligations that tenants will be slightly wary of are things, as I said earlier, like the landlord coming in to do works and recovering the costs from the tenants. So, you know, certainly the letter that our, this one particular client of ours sent out doesn't go that far, but it does agree to things like data sharing, you know, allowing the landlord access, but it's at its absolute discretion, things like that. So it's pared down than the obligations or the obligations that are referred to in the toolkit.
It's really interesting to hear that, you know, parties are starting to come together in terms of agreeing these sorts of provisions. Maura, do you have anything to add from a landlord's perspective there?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's really interesting what you've just said, Nick, about how you have a client that sends a letter to their landlord to say this is what we want to achieve from an ESG perspective, because I think on the sort of the flip side, one of the ways that we've been trying to tackle the potential concerns from a tenant in implementing our green lease clauses up until now is we also sort of send a one-pager letter to each of our prospective tenants where we're signing a new lease or a renewal to explain what the different clauses in the green lease are saying. Because I think the first, one of the most important things is to put occupiers at ease, is explaining why the landlord is trying to implement these clauses. So we developed a one-pager in 2021, so a few years ago now, against the elements we had in our green lease clause at the time. So data sharing, not, you know, doing works to worsen the EPC, but explaining the reason behind that, because I think that just gives it a bit of colour and a bit of, you know, context for the occupier, which, as Kirsty mentioned at the beginning, the new lease toolkit, the updated toolkit, has got the statement of intent against each clause. And actually, from doing that and developing that one pager, we really saw quite a bit of uptake in our green lease clauses from the tenants, because I think they felt more comfortable with what the landlord was, you know, trying to impose and, you know, demonstrating a reason behind it. So explaining we're on a net zero carbon journey, we would like your data so we can do more accurate reporting and work collaboratively to creating more energy efficient spaces and achieve our NZC, you know, targets, and hopefully help the occupier towards theirs. I think another point which I think helps, would hopefully help the occupier become more comfortable with these clauses, is demonstrating the benefit that it brings them, particularly potentially from a financial perspective, and kind of using an example, which is very apt, we were talking about it this morning, is we've been working on implementing AI, artificial intelligence technology, across a number of our multi-let offices to try and optimize the building's performance, reduce energy costs, save energy, carbon, and also financially for the occupier. And as of this morning, within nearly a year, we've managed to save about $250,000 in energy costs. Obviously, this has involved the landlord going into the building, installing kit through this technology service to understand how the building's running and save, you know, implement these savings. The cost of this went through the service charge, so obviously was at the, you know, for the occupier to absorb. However, we've saved far more than has gone through the service charge and really demonstrated those savings. So I think being able to say that upfront to the occupiers, you know, as Nick also mentioned, there's a bit of the new toolkit that extends the landlord's rights to do works in the building. And I think if we're able to upfront and say, I know it's, you know, intrusive and we're spending X on doing this and we want a contribution from the tenant, you are going to save this amount. So it sort of really demonstrates that what we're doing is actually creating a benefit for the occupier as well. And I think the kind of final point I wanted to make was there's very much, you know, landlord-tenant, that kind of relationship. And I think we're trying more and more, as I'm sure lots of other landlords are, in creating a partnership and really working collaboratively. And I think it's really important to do that. You know, even the term tenant isn't, you know, used in our business. We very much look at the word occupiers. I know other landlords use a different term to make it less legal, I guess. And I think we're finding that's working really, really well. We've for example, as one of our developments, we've pre-let Holborn Viaduct, large development, to Hogan Lovells, and it's been a really collaborative partnership the whole journey, and it continues to be like that. And I think that's what really makes a, you know, it's important to have that collaboration to, you know, demonstrate the benefits to the occupiers and also the tenants and have that positive relationship. So I think with any kind of new leases, new acquisitions, new developments sort of going forward, we'll definitely be looking to do that even further.
Loads of really interesting stuff to unpack in there. I mean, I think the consensus has to be that early engagement is really important on these matters in terms of bringing everybody together, working collaboratively in a partnership rather than sort of looking to impose terms. Kirsty mentioned earlier that the new toolkit has some sort of precedent heads of terms which might be quite useful in sort of engaging in that. But what's clear to me is before you even start having these conversations as a landowner, landlord, you really need to have in mind a strategy of what it is that you want to achieve with your buildings and how you want to go about implementing that and then evidencing the benefits of that to your tenants. So when I talk to clients about green lease provisions, I always say that they need to have an element of mutuality to them. So it's not the landlord dictating a position to a tenant. They need to be measurable as well. So you can say, well, look, how do I know if people are complying with these provisions or not? And I think, Laura, you touched on data and the key role that that plays in that element. And then an element about it is, as well as enforceability and how that would potentially work if it came to it. And the toolkit's, I think, quite deliberately quite silent on that for the time being. So where to go from there? I mean, I think there's an interesting point around cost benefits analysis, Laura, and data, and the role that plays in terms of evidencing to tenants and taking them with you on that journey in terms of saying, look, this works for everybody here. So how key is that in terms of what you're looking at and what you work on presently?
Absolutely. I think collecting data for me is probably the absolute foundation of any work that we do. It's so key for tracking, as I've mentioned before, our own net zero carbon goals, seeing how we're doing on that journey, but also being able to demonstrate to an occupier through tracking of the data, this is what we've managed to achieve, this is what we've managed to save. So I think the data sharing aspect of that Green Lease Toolkit is really key, and it has been, you know, for some time. And I think it's actually one of the elements of our green lease that gets much less pushback than it used to. I think perhaps because occupiers realize that, you know, the importance of that data sharing aspect. So I think that it's something that we'll definitely be continuing to focus on, collecting lots of hard data, and I think just being able to provide that evidence back to the tenant.
Absolutely. And then in terms of other things to touch on, then again, we mentioned the sort of the different shades of green within the toolkit. And when I was initially reading it, I was thinking there could potentially be a temptation to see the darker sort of shades of green, sort of like a hard entrenched landlord position, and the occupier will be looking very much at the lighter touch sort of provisions. But actually looking through all of it, I think it's not a question of a tug of war from one end to the other. It's very much a sort of a, what level of engagement and what level of priority do we want to have on sustainability issues in this particular building, and forming a consensus around that. And I mean, that might potentially be driven, you know, by the nature of the asset as well. I think, for example, looking at logistics buildings, some of these essential provisions talk about using renewable energy. And the darker option in the toolkit talks about using renewable energy that's generated on site. Now, something that we're advising lots of clients on at the moment on their industrial and logistics estates is PV, battery storage, smart networks, things like that, which clearly, if you've got that sort of setup and planning behind it, feeds itself very well into these sorts of provisions. Whereas perhaps other types of asset, multi-let offices or whatever it might be, may not be quite so well placed to deal with those sorts of things. So, I mean, what sort of role do we think that the type of asset could have in how these clauses are negotiated? Kirsty?
Yeah, it's interesting. So although I have an office background, I do cover office, industrial and retail across the whole of the UK. And I think what's really interesting is often a lot of the conversations, you know, there's a huge amount of overlap, but actually, as you say, within industrial, there is more lower hanging fruit because, you know, in theory, you can actually, it's much easier to generate all of the energy needed on site. As an example, I think there's also more opportunity around like a really well thought through nature strategy and biodiversity often with industrial. So you have got that nuance, but then at the same time, there are some kind of fundamentals which are really transferable across all. So, but yeah, as you say, each asset type has slightly different opportunities and challenges.
I think the key really is to get engagement at heads of term stage. I mean, what we're seeing quite often, especially in the retail sector, is that you will just see a one line in the heads of term saying, you know, the parties will discuss green lease clauses or something meaningless like that. And actually what ends up then happening is that the lawyers are having a conversation about it, which means that the parties aren't really engaging properly in what sits behind those discussions. And I think what the toolkit perhaps could do is set the scene for parties going, okay, well, before we speak to the lawyers, let's just agree, well, you know, what are we going to do about this? You know, if we're worried about doing works during the term, who is going to pay for them? Who is going to do them? And it only needs to be at that level, but I think there does need to be some discussion, or some more discussion than we often see at heads of term stage.
I would actually go one further, Nick, and I would say it needs to be introduced even before you even get to heads of term stage. Like, it is really, and this is another point that I think is really important. You can have the best lease in the world, but if it sits in a drawer and no one knows what to do with it, it kind of becomes pointless. The reality is, yes, it might be difficult negotiating a lease, but the really hard work begins on that, with that ongoing collaboration. And I think having the right stakeholders around the table, and one of those key stakeholders are your agents, the people marketing that property. They should be communicating what you want to achieve from that lease, why you want to achieve it, and what the benefit is to both parties. So that actually by the time you get to heads of terms, it's not even a discussion because those principles have been agreed. So that actually by the time it gets to you guys, it might be a little bit about actually how biting those clauses are, but you're not having to debate the whole principle. Equally, the people negotiating the lease are usually not the people that understand the technicalities behind it, the ESG elements of it, or responsible for implementing it. So you do need to have all of those people around the table as well to kind of really successfully create that decarbonisation strategy, because the lease is one part of that toolkit, but it is just one part. And there are a lot of other supporting behaviours around it that are needed.
I think just to build on what both Kirsty and Nick have said is, I think there's definitely the need for having flexibility on the different asset type with the lease clause, which I think is why it's so helpful having those different shades. And in addition to that, the heads of terms aspect. So we at Raw London, we do have a template for sort of our offices, but not so much for industrial and retail. So I think that the Green Lease Toolkit opens up that opportunity to create heads of terms sector specific, because there are definitely going to be greater opportunities, as mentioned, in industrial for perhaps biodiversity, renewable energy generation versus in office. But then even in retail, we've got a mixture of retail parks, high street retail. And again, that opens up different levels of opportunities and ease for implementing some of those lease clauses. I think further to it, which is probably getting even more into the detail, is I think that the size of the unit or the size of the asset may also change what is, you know, easier to get into the clause or perhaps agree. As mentioned at the start, we've got a lot of very small industrial units where ESG might not be the top of their agenda, or perhaps understand why the landlord is trying to implement a number of clauses. So I think that just having that flexibility is going to be really important. And further to just what Kirsty mentioned on having the right stakeholders in the room, we've been working hard, particularly across our retail space, through our engagement to understand who is the, you know, the focal person on ESG to speak to across all of our engagement opportunities. So we've got sort of a list of who is best to speak to. And I think deducing, you know, those kind of lists on who the key people are from an ESG side, from a leasing side, bringing them all together is really important, because I think we're very, you know, keen, open to having conversations early on, understanding what the occupier's priorities, needs, what their own ambitions are, as well as ours, is a really important starting point.
I think it's fair to say, isn't it, that lease clauses are just one piece of the jigsaw, aren't they? You know, a really well-drafted lease clause is all well and good, but without the supporting information and everything else sitting behind it, it's only, well, probably not going to get you all that far at all. I mean, there's other sorts of supporting documents as well. You can tie, you know, tenant handbooks, waste management plans, things like that, that really flesh out the detail, which will avoid you having a lease which is hundreds of pages long, but is the opportunity for parties to engage on topics like that. So, yeah, that's certainly chimes with me as well. One point I just wanted to cover on which I found interesting about the toolkit. There's an element in there about social value. So looking sort of beyond sustainability, environmental considerations into talking about minimum social safeguards. For example, for those who haven't had a chance to look at the toolkit, there's things about landlords, tenants responding to social impact surveys, complying with anti-slavery and trafficking laws and looking at their supply chains, things like that. Kirsty, what was the rationale in terms of sort of looking at the toolkit and branching out into these areas and just going beyond the mere sort of green, the E aspect of ESG?
Yeah, and actually it was one of the debates we had really early on was whether we still called it a green lease or whether we changed it to a responsible lease or a sustainable lease. I think for the sake of simplicity, we stayed with green lease, but I think everyone in that steer group felt quite strongly that increasingly, you know, as we are getting to grips with the E element of ESG, the S is becoming more and more important and something that should be addressed. And it's interesting, I got asked recently what I thought one of the, given that it's a live, the toolkit's hosted in a live environment, and so it's going to be kind of amended and adapted over time, what element I thought might could be expanded on. And actually, I think kind of that S is actually an area which I think we might see even more on in the future. I think it feels like the direction of travel, certainly in the conversations that I'm having with clients.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, to add to that, Kirsty, I completely agree. So we, in our current green lease clause, should it be called green, as you say, we do have a section on social. It's quite high level at the moment. It's not as in-depth as the toolkit. And I think it's something we definitely look to update. But we receive quarterly feedback from our various lawyers that we use to say where the green lease clause has been implemented, which clauses have been accepted, which are perhaps, you know, the occupiers tried to strike out. And the social one, albeit it being quite new, has actually been accepted in quite a lot of instances. I think because it's not particularly onerous, and I think it's more about collaboration, creating a social value forum, having, you know, conversations with the landlord. I think perhaps occupiers quite like that, as it's less about, you know, maybe hard data and getting access to their data or things like that. I think it also resonates with us well as lots of landlords. I know that social is definitely has become or becoming an increasing focus for ourselves. We're in the development of a social value framework, social value strategy, and we are looking at the sort of whole property life cycle, all of our different documents, including our acquisition toolkit, and looking at property management and sort of leases fall within that remit as well, and understanding how we can work with occupiers to better the social value of their space, have a positive impact on the community. So I think the green lease toolkit and the social aspect might be a way that we can sort of infiltrate that into there as well, as it's definitely becoming a bigger focus for us. I think with social, which again, has definitely been mentioned a lot, and that the toolkit's got a lot of flexibility, I think social flexibility is very, very important, because you really have to consider not just the sector, the size, the location, what the tenant does, what the local community, what's the, you know, the needs and the wants of the local community, in order to identify how best to have a social, you know, increase social value, have a positive social impact. But I think that the toolkit says, quote unquote, you know, this is not a one size fits all approach for social. So I think it's really important that the toolkits acknowledge that.
I think that's the key, isn't it? There isn't a one size fits all answer to this. I mean, just Nick, conscious a lot of the occupiers that you act for will probably have, you know, very extensive policies on matters like this, and they'll have websites and they'll have documents that people can download for transparency and everything like that. What do you think their view would be on sort of starting to incorporate these sorts of provisions in leases? Will they think it's something that they want in a relationship with the landlord in that document? Or is it something where they will say, well, look, we deal with this already. Here's all of our information. This is our thing. We don't want in our lease. Thank you.
I think it's going to be the second option, as noble as it all is. But as you say, Tom, I think that they will point to the fact that they have, well, you know, any big institutional occupier will have a social policy, which is probably freely available. They will want to have that for their own credentials. But I think they will look at the lease and say, well, if this doesn't quite fit in with what we do as some of my occupiers, as a global brand, we're not going to make an exception for one letting. So again, to Kirsty's point earlier, obviously it's not hard and fast. So it's about having a conversation between the parties. What I have seen, to Laura's point, is some high level drafting on a couple of leases for big office lettings in London. But they really are sort of high level. They don't really have any teeth sitting behind them. So the interesting thing to see will be, is there a move generally to more social clauses which actually have some weight behind them, or are we sort of just paying lip service as we probably currently are?
Yeah, it'll be really interesting to see all that evolves. One thing I wanted to touch on, we spoke a little bit about value that might be attributed to green lease provisions and incorporating those going forwards, and also the value of engagement and really being able to evidence to occupiers why we, as a landlord, you're looking to include these types of provisions. I suppose there might be an element in the market of landowners who feel they should be putting these sorts of provisions in, if only to sort of future-proof their assets, or potentially if they're looking to dispose further down the line, an incoming investor might have these as a requirement. Is there perhaps, a danger as a landowner that going into these negotiations, you try and put these in even though your heart's not really in it, to preserve something further down the line, and then not being able to evidence to your occupier that you're doing so for the right reasons, and therefore struggling to get these clauses in at all?
Yeah, I think there is always that concern. I don't think we'd want to be trying to put stuff into the clause sort of naturally. We do obviously have to protect ourselves. We do want it to be something that is beneficial to both us, but also sort of beneficial to the occupier. Mm-hmm. I think from that value perspective, it's a really interesting one, because I think, which was touched upon at the start, about how the valuation space is moving towards that potential green premium, brown discount. I think that in a way, green leases will potentially both directly, but also indirectly link to that. I think that what's been seen in the market is there's definitely a growing link between EPC level, EPC rating and value, and potentially also BREEAM certifications having a bit of an impact on that. And naturally within the green lease clause, what we've been trying to obviously put forward, which the BBP toolkit is also keen for, is around not worsening the EPC through fit out or types of works that the occupier might do. So I think having a clause in there would probably protect ourselves going forward regarding if, that strength of valuation impact from EPCs and other certifications does move forward. And I think from a net zero stance as well, I think that will definitely start forming part of the valuation, maybe arguably starting to already. But I think as the market moves towards having more net zero carbon buildings in the industry, there'll be a stronger market signal. Therefore, that will start impacting value. So I think we do perhaps need to start thinking about that more, of if we don't get certain clauses in there to, decarbonize the building, and green leases for us particularly with that heavily weighted single let portfolio is a real key way of getting into the getting able to have those opportunities to improve the building's efficiency, work towards net zero carbon. I think we may start have to thinking a bit more in that protective way as the market starts seeing ESG having an impact on value for sure. But I think to build on that, again, it all comes back to explaining to the occupier why we're trying to do these things. And, at the moment, it isn't to do with valuation, I would say, really. There's so many other aspects and reasons we're doing it, mainly because of our own commitments. But I think just really drawing it back to giving them a clear reason why we're doing this and, bringing them on that journey as such as well is really important.
And I don't think that tenants would buy the sort of valuation argument if that's the way that landlords wanted to sort of couch it, because from the occupier's perspective, well, so what? That's nothing to do with me. You are doing a deal with me now. I don't care whether that affects your valuation going forward. You need to make sure that the heads of terms are such that you're happy with that deal for the rest of the term. But as Laura said, I think if that conversation is couched in terms of, okay, but what are you, tenant, getting from this, whether or not it be as simple as just you're getting utility savings, that's much more likely to work, I think, than looking at value.
Mm-hmm. I'm just conscious of time. We're getting some really good questions in. So I just want to round up our sort of initial discussion with a quick question for all of you, please. Is there a way to make green lease provisions work for both investors and occupiers? Who wants to start? Kirsty?
I'll kick off. I think they do. I think it's interesting. I've got a slide which I use quite a lot. I should have brought it along today, which sets out the benefits for landlords and the benefits for occupiers from what you can get through really successful collaboration. And so many of them are the same. You know, you want an efficiently run building. You want lower running costs. You know, you want tenant engagement. You want your occupiers to stay. You know, there's so much symmetry in actually what you're trying to achieve. And I think, again, it's one of the things that I really like about the toolkit is that it does help with that kind of that preamble, sets out why it's important, and it helps frame that conversation around what those benefits are. And so I think we've already shifted from that mindset of it's all landlord imposed obligations onto the tenant. I do think we are kind of really moving towards that partnership model. And I think, you know, the landlords that don't do that are going to be a bit left behind.
Yeah, I think I was thinking exact same as Kirsty with regards to there's so many benefits for both parties in having these lease clauses and setting that out is going to be really important. I think there may be there is definitely a reason that it does work for both parties. I think perhaps in time it might be slower for certain, you know, groups of occupiers, as mentioned, perhaps the smaller ones who are, you know, not as advanced on their ESG or net zero carbon journeys. But I still think over time we will get to that point across the whole market and all sort of occupier types, sizes, etc., where it does work, because, you know, ESG shot up their agenda as it is across a number of occupiers, and we're seeing that as well. With getting more questions on how the building's performing. We've got one of our occupiers who's trying to set science-based targets. They need to collect data on the building. So it's, you know, right at the forefront of them. And we are seeing more and more of that. So I think, yeah, just demonstrating the benefits to both and the reasons behind it is really key for both parties.
Great. Nick, briefly, your thoughts?
Yeah, it all just boils down to cost, really. I think at the end of the day, yeah, big institutional tenants have their own ESG policy. And yeah, at the minute, there is a disparity between what that looks like and what they are asking for in terms of protection at least. So I think necessarily we will see tenants soften their position. But the big one really is who pays for all of this? And I think the market hasn't yet settled on that answer. And that's the sort of the million-dollar question, really, as to where the market goes with that.
Great. Thank you. Got so many great questions in here. I'm just going to pick out a few to touch on now. I think we mentioned the significance of data sharing and the importance of data generally in evidencing to occupiers that these provisions actually are mutually beneficial. One of the questions we've had in is about overcoming the sensitivities around sharing of data. Any thoughts on how that's best overcome?
I'll just jump in here from a tenant's perspective. So up until this point, if we sort of ignore the tech that sits or that could sit behind this data capture, the issue that tenants look at when they see these types of data sharing clauses is that we don't want the administrative burden. So, you know, a landlord may have a massive portfolio and want consistency across that portfolio, but so do big institutional occupiers as well. So they don't want to have lots of different reporting obligations for lots of different landlords, some which, you know, are hard and fast obligations, some which don't, you know, the clauses in the lease don't actually sort of hold any weight or have teeth behind them. So from that perspective, if it's still a manual data sharing obligation, that's a really big no-no from an occupier perspective. Mm-hmm. If to Laura's point earlier that we can really see the increase in sort of tech for data capture, that will make it, I think, a lot more palatable for tenants. Ostensibly, if they don't really have to do anything and the data is just captured and the data is what the data is, then I don't see that they should have a problem with that.
It's one of the things that actually the toolkit does address, because it really does recognise that administrative burden. And so, I mean, obviously tech and having kind of a really efficient system that does it all automatically is fantastic. But one of the things that the toolkit also allows for is for landlords to, with the consent of the occupiers, contact the utility companies directly and get that information so that actually the occupiers don't have to do anything after that initial sign off. So it does seek to address that.
Yeah. I think to come at it actually from what we've seen a landlord is, the administrative burden point is definitely one that I think we've seen, particularly across retailers. But actually what we have noticed mainly in retailers, they'd rather share their data through a spreadsheet, through their own means, rather than us connecting to their meters or through a technology. I think there is that hesitation that we're going to use this data against our occupiers or name and shame, which obviously is absolutely not what we're looking to do. We're trying to just capture the data for reporting purposes, but also understand how we are along that journey. I think that on the data, there is sometimes some pushback because from, say, a retailer's perspective, their priority is not the emissions from their building, it's their supply chain. That is where the bulk of their emissions, their scope three, sits. So I think they're perhaps, you know, not as, you know, don't see the importance as such of sharing that with us. Whereas for us, obviously, our scope three is, you know, 90% of our emissions or something like that. But I do think that, you know, hopefully as technology evolves, we're able to demonstrate this kind of the safety behind it, the cybersecurity, all those aspects, we can hopefully move towards that ease of sharing data. And again, it's all to do with that explaining why we want the data. I think that's what gives occupiers hopefully comfort in what we're doing. We're not looking to use it against occupiers. We're looking at it to almost help them as well along their own journeys as too. And to build on that, sorry, we're talking a while on the same question, but actually we have worked with one occupier to install metering where they can access the live data themselves on a platform that we both have access to. And through that, the occupiers use that to understand where their electricity consumption is spiking at different points. They've then contacted the technology company that we've used to install that equipment to then help them further reduce their emissions and their carbon footprint. And it was a case study in one of our most recent reports. So actually, I think that being able to provide those options to occupiers, having a central data sharing platform, both the landlord, the occupier can view, showing the benefits to them that way as well, has been quite powerful for us.
It's probably also worth, sorry, just Tom, just mentioning enforcement as well, just from a legal perspective. So, you know, the types of data sharing clauses we've seen so far are sort of good faith clauses. You know, what tenants have tried to steer away from is any sort of absolute obligation or sometimes even a reasonable endeavours obligation with the risk sitting behind that, that the landlord could try and enforce it, albeit unlikely. Some tenants have gone so far as to say they want a specific carve out from forfeiture. Again, perhaps overkill, but it goes to show that they are nervous about the obligations as a whole. So tech could be really useful actually to get rid of that nervousness.
Yeah, I think enforcement's a really interesting point and probably something we could fill an hour in on its own easily. I mean, in terms of how do you evidence loss as a landlord if someone doesn't give you their environmental performance data for a quarter or something like that? You know, how do you rush that through? What sort of sanctions might you want to put into the lease in terms of dealing with things like that? So I think that's a really interesting angle. One of the questions we've had I thought was interesting was, you know, does choosing light green clauses demonstrate a lesser green ambition? Kirsty, what do you think?
Look, everyone's on different places with their sustainability journey, and every asset is also going to have its own nuance. And so it's really about looking at what's appropriate for you. And I just think I personally don't have an issue with lighter clauses, because actually it's setting that principle. And I think the more that this comes into the kind of realm of conversation and the more it's discussed, I think the more ambitious it will become over time. Mm-hmm. And so personally, I don't have a problem with that. I did see another one about another question about if you start now with light green, how can it adapt over time? I think one of the things that the toolkit also does is it's got a general kind of collaboration clause, but also looking at actually how that's governed. And I think, as I said earlier, and as Laura will know, you know, yes, negotiating the lease can be tricky, but the real work comes after that with that ongoing collaboration. And I think if you get that right from the start and you have a really, really effective collaboration strategy, you will evolve and you will be operating your buildings in the most sustainable way and getting those sustainable outcomes. And so, you know, even if the lease starts off as light green by the end of that time and that through that collaboration process, I think you can end up being really ambitious.
I think that's an important point, isn't it? A lease is a pretty long-term document. You know, you're talking 10, 15, 20 plus potentially years in terms of how long that document will govern the relationship. And inevitably things will change and there's the scope for parties to evolve how they approach these sorts of matters. One question I think we've had in, which is quite a good one that is looking forward, is we've waited 11 years for an update to the BBP toolkit. Do you think we'll have to wait until 2035 for the next update? I suspect the answer to that will be no.
Well, no, because now it is hosted in a live environment. And so it will be evolving. There will be a governance structure around that. There'll be a governance group with set meetings. And so, and like I said, there is a feedback form as well. And so this is definitely something that the BBP are looking to kind of constantly evolve and maintain to reflect kind of the changing needs.
Fantastic. And I think that's a good note on which to throw a line under the questions, because we're almost at the end of our time. There's loads of questions we haven't got to yet. We'll come back to all of those separately. So thank you, everybody, for sending those in. I think it's fair to say the conversation around the toolkit update is just beginning and will no doubt continue for some time. On that note, a quick reminder, please, to complete our short feedback survey that will pop up. One of the questions on that is whether you'd be interested in continuing this conversation with us and how. So please do answer that. Help us organise more events just like this, perhaps something in person, because we'd love to hear directly from what you've got to say as well. To generate one last soundbite before we wrap up, I will close with a quick fire question to the panel about how strongly they agree or disagree with the following statement. BBP toolkit provisions will be included in most leases granted within the next 2 years. Laura.
I would say I definitely do agree with that, because I think that, you know, as Kirsty has mentioned and I've mentioned as well, you know, I think all of us mentioned actually, is there is definitely more appetite from occupiers to uptake some aspects of the green lease clauses. I didn't want to say strongly agree, because as I've said a few times, we do have such, you know, a lot of smaller units that aren't perhaps the multi-let offices, who are the bigger corporates with those higher sustainability ambitions, who do want to, you know, join on those perhaps darker green clauses. Perhaps there'll be more lighter green and then moving to darker green on those smaller aspects. But I definitely think there will be, over the next 2 years, a much greater uptake. And I think that flexibility of the toolkit will really play into that.
Kirsty?
I hope so. I mean, without a tenant engagement strategy, you don't have a sustainability strategy. So you're going to have to address it at some point. And this, I think, is just a really helpful toolkit and guidance to kind of help you on that journey.
Nick?
I think it very much depends on the size of the parties. So in that regard, you know, big institutional landlords and big institutional tenants are already having the conversation to some extent. Smaller landlords and smaller tenants, not so much. So I think that the people who already know about these types of issues are aware of the toolkit, and it will further their conversation or further the journey, as Kirsty has said. But for smaller landlords and smaller tenants, the issue is going to be making them aware of it and getting that into their sort of subconscious at the heads of term stage, so that they can really have this conversation at the outset.
So I think I would side with everything that everybody's mentioned here. I would say strongly agree, but with some caveats. Typical lawyer answer. Laura, Kirsty, Nick, thank you so much for being part of the panel, for sharing your views and knowledge. It's been an absolute pleasure to have this conversation with you. And thank you again to everyone who's joined us today. There are lots of you, which shows just how important this topic is. Thank you very much for your time, and I hope you all have a great afternoon.